So yes, IPM, you've got here sustainable approach to manage pests by combining, as we said, biological, cultural, physical, and chemical tools in a way that minimizes impact, health, and environmental risks, with priority to all the tools, and at the end, if we don't have, we choose the chemical tool. So you can read after all this definition. We don't have a lot of time. So for you, what is organic crop? You know that there is a big market. If you go to the supermarket and you have the selection, you can choose between conventional food or organic food. Do you know what is on the organic food? Do you think we can treat or we don't treat? Or what is your opinion? What is your... They are not
antibiotics also.
Even in conventional, we don't treat with conventional, so it's not really.
It is treated, but there are some regulations that you have the exact amount allowed for, I don't know, some kind of pesticide, for mineral nutrition, for you have.
You will have also in conventional. So this is not the big difference?
Natural controls.
Okay, we come near the definition. Natural control. So indeed, when we speak about organic crops, you are allowed to use, it's easier in the other way. You are not allowed to use synthetic pesticides. So, pesticide created by the human. Okay? And a second thing, you are not allowed to use fertilizer, artificial fertilizer. But you are allowed to give nutrition, but you are allowed to use organic matter to give food to your plants. Concerning protection, you are not allowed to use synthetic chemical pesticides, but you're allowed to use natural pesticides. Even mineral natural pesticides like copper, sulfur. And copper, you know that it can be really toxic for the soil when you have an accumulation of copper. So, okay, organic cropping, I think it's good for the health of human, because most of the natural pesticides are contact pesticides, so you wash your commodity and you throw away everything. But for the environment, it's still so. It's a good first step, but I think for the plant protection people, we need to go further and to carry on the research of alternative tools. And of course, with organic crop, you can also use a biocontrol agent. But you can use biocontrol agent also in IPM. Okay? So you have the definition here. You can read it if you want after. And we speak also now with new terminology like sustainable agriculture. And sustainable concern three pillars, sociological pillar, ecological or environmental, and economic. And you can read, it has to satisfy human food and fiber needs, enhance environmental quality, make the most efficient use of non-renewable resources, sustain the economic viability of farm operation. It's important. The farmer has to live from what he's doing. And enhance the quality of life for farmer and society as a whole. This is the European definition of sustainable agriculture. And you can link, when you see this, you can link different new way of cropping, agroforestry, permaculture, agroecology, but also aquaponics. And of course, when we speak, as I told you, the main way to protect plants, it's still pesticides, chemical pesticides. And we know that if we use too often one or two pesticides, so you don't have a good management of your pesticides, you will have appearance of resistant population of pathogen. And more there is limitation of authorized active ingredients. When I started 25 years ago, there was more than 1,000 active ingredients as pesticides. Nowadays, it's, do you know, Peter, it's like four or five?
Less than 100.
No, it's more. It's 200 to 300, more or less. It's still, but you see a big, big decrease already of active ingredients in Europe. And even with this reduced active ingredients, there is some demand of growing the delay between the last spray in the field and the harvest time, because you want to avoid residue on your commodity. And of course, and this is why organic products are so popular, there is a even if it fits so as I told you, there is a real demand of the consumer. They are no reluctant to the chemical residue and to the environmental safety. So this is supported by retailers. So there is more and more emergence of new marketing labels, among them organic label. And there is, of course, a growing interest to develop complementary or alternative methods to synthetic fungicides. So of course, if you are still in an IPM system, and of course, if you are Bayer or Syngenta, so, you know, the big player with pesticides, you will speak about complementary. If you are more convinced about your biocontrol agents that can have a lot of effects, you will speak about alternative methods. Okay? And 10 years ago, Bayer or Syngenta even didn't look at us as a biocontrol agents. Nowadays they do, and they acquire a small enterprise with biocontrol products. So finally, they take care also about that kind of products. They integrate them in their portfolio. And the way they integrate them is to have an anti-resistant strategy to avoid the appearance of resistant pathogen populations when you use too many times the same fungicide, and also to avoid residue in the harvested community. Okay? So what is a biopesticide? There are two important terms to keep in mind. It's biocontrol agent or biological control agent. We call it BCA. And the second is biopesticide. Biopesticide is indeed the formulated biocontrol agent. So this is a final product. But the active ingredient, this is a biocontrol agent. And it can be fungi, bacteria, viruses, product derived from this microorganism, so extract of this microorganism. It can be also extract of plants, what we call botanicals, natural substance, like semiochemicals also for insects, for example. Nowadays, they use pheromone as attractant or repellent to disturb the insects. And of course, like any pesticide, a biocontrol agent is able to block one or more stage of the epidemiology. So when you've got infection of a fungus, first you've got germination and penetration. This is infection. Then it develops inside the tissue. So it's multiplication, it's incubation phase, and then it go out the plant or the surface of the leaf, for example, and produce spores which are able to contaminate other plants. And you can block one of these different steps with your biocontrol agent. So this is a scientific definition, but we've got, and I think it's important also to see that legislation is not always in accordance with the scientific definition, and it's not always in accordance from one region to another. Here, this is a definition from USA. So EPA is the Environmental Protection Agency. And you've got three categories of biopesticides. You've got microbial pesticides. So the first definition is like a microorganism, bacteria, and so on. So it's OK. It can be included in the scientific definition. The last one also, biochemical pesticide. It's like pheromone, for example. But look at the second one. The second one is plant incorporated protectants. So it means the genetic material that you add to the plant to make it resistant to a pathogen. So indeed, you are creating a GMO. Can you imagine that here in Europe, we call a GMO a biocontrol agent? In USA, this is the case. Okay, so it's just to show you the difference of culture reflecting by legislation. And in Europe, you've got another definition, which is more like the consensus of the scientific community. And it takes into account this legislation, all the different methods, including biocontrol methods. And when we speak about biocontrol methods, we speak about microorganisms. So you can see this is kind of definition, including alive microorganisms like bacteria, fungi, but also viruses. And it's also include plant extract and semiochemicals, so pheromones. So European legislation is more in accordance with the scientific definition, okay? And it's under a regulation. So it's not a directive, it's a regulation. It means that when you transfer legislation to the at the national level, you are obliged to respect everything which is said in the regulation. A directive you can still interpret it, but a regulation you have to do as it is written. Okay. So you can see that we can have several biocontrol agents. I have already told you about semiochemical, microbial substance, botanicals, other natural substance. They belong to a regulation. And you also have microbial, for example, other insects that can parasite some insects, predatory insects, and so on. And you've got also elicitors. We will speak a little bit of elicitors later on. The elicitors, it's substance that are able to stimulate the defense of, of the host, the defense of the plant. And of course, elicitors can become from natural molecules, but also from synthetic molecules. So it can be both a biocontrol agent or a chemical agent. This is why I don't put automatically elicitor in the biocontrol agent. So let's speak about the market of biopesticides. And of course, when I start I made my PhD on biocontrol agents. When I started, my question was, okay, we can observe natural phenomenon of biocontrol. So, for example, a fungus who is able to protect a plant against another fungus. but how to make it a strategy which is efficient and reliable. And that was really what I always kept in mind when developing the strategy and considering, of course, all the different limits we can have, biological, technological, economical, and legislative. You see here the pesticide world market, and you can see that I finished my PhD in 1996, and you can see that at that time, it was 0.00001% of the market. So it represents nothing at that time. A little bit like aquaponics in comparison with agriculture today. So you see, after 20 years, we have 2.5 billion. This is annual turnover of biopesticides, in comparison with more or less 60 billion for the total global annual turnover of pesticides. So it means that it represents more or less 4% of the market. We are really in the taking over of this market. And if we speak about regional market, you can see here the two important markets are North America and Europe, but also now Asia. 10 years ago, Asia was few percent. Now it's 20%. And it is estimated that in 2020, in 4 years, Europe will take again the lead, because the last 5 years, there were more biocontrol agents registered than chemical agents registered. 22 biocontrol agents versus 20. So it means that it will come to the market soon, and it is estimated that the European market for biocontrol agents will grow in the following years. Yes?
Why is the estimation for North America so bad? Severe breakdown.
I'm not sure it's because of GMO. I think it's they won't grow. They will still carry on to grow, but in a relative proportion, it is estimated that really there will be a big explosion of the market in Europe. And of course, Asia, it's an exploding market, so it's still growing a little bit.
But it's not due to Donald Trump or something like
that? No, because at that time, we didn't know that Donald Trump was one of the potential elected president. So, no. So another estimation I found is that the market will grow around 16% a year over the next 5 years, whereas that growth will be only around 6% for pesticides. And yes, it is estimated that within 3 years, it will represent 5 billion of the total, 5 billion, the market of biopesticides. So it's estimation. And it's estimation if some major drawback will take off, will be stopped or solved, I would say. And what are the major drawbacks of biocontrol agent? The first one is efficacy and reliability. If we speak, for example, about a microorganism under field environment, like us, maybe they don't like rain like today, or if it's too cold. So 1 year, because of the bad weather, you will not have a protection, and another year, you will have protection. So you will have kind of 1 year of efficacy, 1 year without efficacy. So we really have to understand what are the detrimental factors to avoid it, to avoid such a fluctuation of efficacy. Another point is the shelf life of the product. Again, a chemical pesticide, it's an inert molecule. So when you produce it, you can store it for 2 years. And the grower expects that you will have the same shelf life with your biocontrol agents, 2 years. But most of the biocontrol agents are microorganisms. And it's difficult to sometimes to ensure a shelf life of 2 years. Sometimes it's 6 months, 1 year. I used to work with some products that you have to store in the fridge or to store in the freezer. But then you can imagine that the distribution channel, all the distributors need also to acquire a fridge or a freezer and also the growers. So it's a little bit it's still a drawback. And sometimes also you need more sophisticated application, more technical skills. Again, because it's a microorganism, maybe you have to dissolve it in a small bucket, wait 1 or 2 hours, and then put it in the big tank. In opposite, a chemical, you just put in the big tank and go to your field. Even that kind of two steps preparation instead of one step, it can constitute a limit for the grower. So, biopesticide for aquaponic. Is it a possibility or not? First of all, what are the suitable, because maybe we have also other tools available to work in aquaponics? I told you already about genetic resistance. It's important. Please don't avoid it when you select your varieties for aquaponic. If you have the choice for in terms of equivalency of yield and taste and so on between a sensitive and a resistant, go for the resistant. But ask the question to your dealer of seeds. Second point is cultural practices. And people who are working in greenhouse, they know that one really important period in the day is in the morning, because it's like outside, you can have dew on your plants, humidity, which is really bad. And this morning you had to recognize botrytis, for example. If you had a humid morning in a greenhouse, and it can happen in April, like now, because the night are still very cool, and the day normally are hotter. So you have really humidity in your leaves, then it can be a catastrophe with botrytis. And also the density, as I told you already, it's just example. Sanitary measures are also important. We were speaking with Zala about, she told me, I never have a disease. Why? At least one of the reasons is because she is cleaning, or they are cleaning, all the stuff of the pipelines and the disinfection, and which is important. So sanitary measure can help to prevent the arrival of diseases. I forgot here to mention the physical. So you can add physical, like putting UV light. And then biopesticide can be also applied in aquaponics. And of course, we have to keep in mind there are several stakeholders in the aquaponic system. The plants, the fish, and microorganisms, which will help to have the right nutrition of the plant. So if you add an extra microorganism, how will the whole system react? This is something we have to take into account. And of course, because we cannot use pesticides, it was already mentioned yesterday by Peter, and we have to insist on that. We cannot use in a loop system, we cannot use pesticides because it will go to the fish. So the only way, if we want to have some control measure, it's biocontrol agents. And when we speak about biocontrol agents, I was looking at the literature. You can find, and Jill also, for the hydroponic literature, we can find some articles dealing with the application of antagonists of microorganisms, and you can have good results. I will show you some example. But we don't know for aquaponics. There is no result with aquaponics. Maybe some practical results coming now. Maybe Kevin know a little bit more.
Not yet.
Us, it's the same. We don't have a big experience with biocontrol in aquaponics. So this, we are really in an early stage to develop protection of plants in aquaponic system. So yes, there are two possibilities. Try to apply existing one or developing novel which are maybe more adapted. If we want to go in a fast way, in a practical way, of course it's better to start with the first solution. Are there existing biopesticides? And you can see here, this is a work that was prepared by Gilles, and he gave to our students some case of studies. So he found in literature the possible application of the biopesticide against the pathogen on one of these plants. So it means that it does already exist some biopesticides. And you can find them on internet, and you can, this is some example, okay? And you can also notice that most of them are microorganisms. So Pythium, Gliocladium, it's fungi, Bacillus pseudomonas, bacteria, Trichoderma, Conitorium, fungus. You've got Lysobacter, it's bacteria, Streptomyces, bacteria, and you've got one elicitor, which is an oligosaccharide. So most of them are microorganisms. Here, if you want to have some information about the existing list, you can go to the best one. Here, this is the legislation. And here you will find a list of pesticides. And if you go to advanced search, you click on advanced search, then you can put fungicide, herbicide, and then you will see what kind of possibility do you have. Another important point is also, it's not because it is authorized by Europe, that it is automatically authorized by your country, even if you are a European country. It always has to come from Europe to the national level. So I advise you also to see your national contact. Of course, it's different from one country to another, so I didn't take time to put everything, but you have to see here some example of site, and there again you have to search with the right term and right keywords to find if you can find a product for your crop. Okay. And this is an example of approved substance. You can see Trichoderma. It's very well known, and for many, many years it was one of the first registered fungus as a biopesticide in Europe. You've got, for example, Bacillomyces. You've got some Pseudomonas, so and Bacillus, this is bacteria. Even you have some viruses. You have essential oil. Until now, most of the essential oils who are authorized are against insects and not plant pathogen, not fungi or bacteria. Sorry?
I'm not sure how smart it is to mess with weak strains of viruses, because plant viruses are highly recombinant, and you can create, like, if weak strain is there and the strong strain is there, you can create some kind of new strain which is more.
So that could be, but it's so we call it hypovirulent strain.
So also
it happens
all the time in nature.
And it happens also with bacteria.
Yeah.
You know, Agrobacterium.
Yeah.
It's a bacteria. When it's infecting the plant,
it
injects DNA inside the cell of the plants, and you have a big proliferation of the cells, and the cells start to produce some amino acids which are only a source of nutrition for the bacteria. And we found, not us, but in the literature, some scientists found avirulent agrobacterium, and they start to use it as hypervirulent strain, so a strain which is there, and of course if it's there, when your virulent strain arrive, no place anymore. But they observe recombination, exchange of DNA sequence, and then it become also virulent. So yes, it can be a risk. Okay, and here you see Agrobacterium radioactive K84 was not approved. This is a column of not approved, and I suppose that because it was already known that it can lose the control of the bacteria. So the question is also, of course, by existing biopesticides, are they compatible with aquaponic system? What do you think we have to look after in terms of compatibility?
If they are not pathogenic to the fish, then they are, in my opinion, more compatible with aquaponics because of the organic matter system. And most of them are heterotrophic, so.
Yes.
It's a theory that probably is
correct.
Also,
Sebastian?
You rely on like numerous microorganisms for your nitrification and whatever, and you don't want to affect these either. Otherwise, it's not the one working.
So you don't want to affect the biofilter. So we have to take care about fish, about microorganisms from the biofilter.
So we basically need something that doesn't go in the water or doesn't stay in the water.
Most of them.
So, if you have, yes.
Yes, in principle, water is correct, but think about the pipes, where, for instance, trichoderma can settle itself and collide the pipes.
Also, but for the water, you can have disease who are arriving from the water, like pytium. So, in this case, you need something in the water. Most of the problem in the hydroponic system we meet are not most, but some of the problem are coming from the roots, so from the water. So we need, in that case, you have to go also inside the water.
My doubts are about even if they are compatible with, if they can compete with the existing microflora. Like if you don't have them like regularly in big amounts, they're probably not effective.
And there you are considering a microorganism.
Yeah.
Yes. What about essential oil, extract of plant? Then it's not a problem to compete. You just give the right dose.
Yeah.
But we can have also for the fish, is it compatible? Also, the smell of your fish. Imagine that extract of garlic is really well known to protect against disease. But I'm not sure that you want your fish smell garlic, not automatically.
We need something with a very low resident time.
Persistence?
Persistence. Degrades himself very quickly. So for example, for the example of this morning for the pythium, if you have a one loop system, the most convenient thing would be if you can kind of for maybe a week decouple your system and just treat the water in the adjacent part. And if the pesticide, the biopesticides after 1 week disappeared and treat it, that would be the best.
Yes, but also maybe not. I mean, it's a good point. No, I mean, we have to build it. Huh? You realize that nothing was done, so we have to think about it. Because another point is, and we know that if we run the aquaponic system for months and months and maybe years, you will have a kind of stabilization of your microbiota. And maybe within the microbiota, we will have beneficial one who create a barrier against a pathogen. And then you want it stable, and not just short time. So there are still several ways to control nowadays, several solutions. And your is a good one, and maybe stability of the microbiota could be another one. We have to explore them. We are just at the beginning. And this is a characteristic of an ideal biocontrol agent in general. And when you see in blue, I put some extra characteristic for aquaponics. So efficient at low concentration is better, of course. Also, if we want to produce them, and it's cost to produce them, it's better to have a small dosage, it's okay. Low nutrient requirement, of course, because they will not perturbate the other microorganisms and organisms. Able to survive under any conditions, and here particularly aquaponic conditions. And we were speaking about competition with other population of microbiota, and also temperature, oxygen, pH, all these things, if we are under water. It's better to have a biocontrol agent which is efficient against a large spectrum of pathogens. When we speak about microorganisms, it's really rare to find that kind of quality. Easy to prepare and to use. And I told you sometimes it's a little bit sophisticated to handle it before application. No secondary metabolites. It's better. Otherwise, maybe you will end like a classical pesticide. Compatibility with other treatments. No risk for plant, normally for human and environment. And here we have to add for aquaponic system, no risk for fish. No risk for other microorganisms. And if it's a microorganism genetically stable, it's better. And we spoke already about it. So the second possibility is to develop novel biopesticides. If the one we have at disposal are not efficient or not adapted to aquaponic system, maybe we have to develop a novel biopesticide. And there are still two two ways. The first one is to select one super strain. So like we used to do with conventional agriculture, non-aquaponic agriculture. And this is why sometimes in hydroponic system, some microorganisms are able to survive, to struggle and compete against other microbiota or the population of microorganisms, and at the same time efficient against one pathogen. But sometimes we see also in the hydroponic literature that it doesn't work. That one strain was not enough efficient to survive and to compete. So that can be one possibility. And the second one is to define conditions in favor of beneficial microbiota. And this is why you learn NGS techniques. It can help to do that, to follow the microbiota in aquaponic system and to see if there are some conditions that are able to favor good microorganisms and others which are not favorable for the beneficial microbiota. And again, also, it has to be compatible with the environmental conditions in favor of the plants and maybe on the fish. Okay. Some questions about this? And before we go further, thanks to our COS meeting in Ljubljana, we met people from Canada. And discussing with them, this is nowadays the only article dealing with aquaponics.
There are some more? There are some guys, even American guys, working only on one strain of the bacterium is A. Bradylance. It's kind of PGPR.
You can send to everybody.
Yeah.
It'll be great. Please.
There's nothing special actually. There are.
Okay, there may be some. But here, this is more like in favor of the second option. That's what I want to say. Not to go with one super strain, but to go with maybe a microbiota. And here, what have they done? They put fish effluent at different percentage of the, I would say, aquaponic solution or hydroponic solution. And they control the number of propagules of pathogen per root, per gram of root. And you can see that if they increase the percentage of fish effluent, they have a decrease of colonization of the root by Pythium or by Fusarium. And they go further, also in vitro, and they sterilize the fish effluent. And when they sterilize it, they see a decrease of protection, meaning that microorganisms might play a role here in the protection. Which one? Question mark. How many? Biodiversity? Question mark. So it's a good first paper, open new perspective. We're going to make a short break of few minutes, and then we will see if we need to develop a super strain, or we'll see how we have to develop it. We're going to move to the next part of my talk. It's the different steps to develop a biopesticide. And I will try to give examples for each step, considering not three but four cases of study Gliocladium. It's a fungus. It's a biocontrol agent. Candida oleophila, it's a yeast. I will speak also about essential oils and a little bit about illicit oils at the end. Then we will have a global picture. So this is how we work. This is the different steps to develop a biopesticide. First, you have to define your market, of course. Then you have to isolate your active ingredient. It can be a microorganism, essential oil, extract of plant, and so on. You have to select them. And from the beginning, please try to see if you can produce them, because you can have a really efficient active biocontrol agent. If you cannot produce in mass, no way to go further. And please check also already some toxicological point, like go to the if you have a strain of microorganism, identify it and go to internet to see if it's already known to be toxic or toxic for the environment. If it's the case, forget it. They are full of literature with Pseudomonas aeruginosa. This is a human pathogen. And you've got a lot of literature of this bacteria, this species, to be used as a biocontrol agent. You can imagine that then in practice, it will be never used. So that can help during the selection process to avoid that kind of problem. And then, of course, you have other different steps, mode of action, formulation. We will see them a little bit more. Ecology, and of course, efficacy, pilot trials. It's important. So first, let's go to the selection. If we speak about microorganisms, first you have to isolate them. We can isolate them for the surface of the plant that you have to protect. It's better. Here you find some example on petri dish of bacteria, of yeast. This is coming from washing of apples, for example, to protect apples. Then something really, really important. If you want to select a microorganism, please go immediately with the plant you want to protect. Don't start to make a dual culture on a petri dish because maybe you will have a clear inhibitory of your pathogen, but it's in vitro. And you never know if the microorganism will act in the same way on your plant. And they are full of literature saying there is not always a clear relation between efficacy in vitro and efficacy in vivo. For microorganisms, okay? So go for in vivo test. And of course, you have seen that it's not often easy to reproduce a disease, because if you want to go in vivo, you have to reproduce a disease. You saw this morning botrytis on tomato, because we were able to reproduce a disease, but it's not always so often, so easy. Okay? So you need to develop a protocol for symptoms reproduction, and then to assess your microorganisms. And here, this is the steps, an example, which was done during my PhD. So it's we were searching for microorganisms able to protect apples against post-harvest diseases, wound parasites, botrytis, you saw it on tomato, but it's also possible to develop this disease on apples. And this is the symptoms. Penicillium, it's also a wound parasite, so it means that it will develop if you have a wound on your fruit. Okay. And how do we, did we process? First, we sterilized the apple surface. Why do you think we did that?
Because there are other microorganisms.
Exactly. If we apply one specific strain, we want to be sure this is that strain which is responsible of efficacy. And if we don't sterilize, maybe it will come from other population, microbial population. Then, because it was wound parasite, we create a wound, and then we inoculate, we treat with a microorganism, and then we inoculate with a pathogen. And you can see that in comparison with a control, sometimes we have protection, but weak protection, and sometimes with some other microorganisms, we have strong protection. You can see here, for example, no symptom at all. So, of course, that kind of microorganism is of interest. And we select one of them, which is Candida oleophila. And I will come back later with it. But that method was really time-consuming because we have to isolate a lot of different microorganisms and one by one to test them. So if I had to start again today, I would go to this way. For example, if I observe a healthy fruit in contact with a fruit with symptoms, it might indicate that on your healthy fruit you have got some beneficial microorganisms. Or another thing, you just wash all the microbiota and then you put directly on the plant or the wound here you want to protect. If there is something going on, then go back to the wound and take out the different microorganisms. Again, you go faster with this way. For plant extract, normally might have a direct effect against the pathogen. So there, you can go in vitro. We did that. This is a work of Olivier Parisi. So we did it, and we select 20 plant pathogens, which are really important for Belgium or in Europe. And we pre-select 90 essential oils. Because, you know, essential oils, they can be very expensive, like extract of rose, for example, is a few thousand euros a kilo. So you can imagine that a grower will not apply it in his field. So the pre-selection was, do we have some essential oil at low price, a price that will be per hectare affordable by the grower, and also essential oil that, imagine that you have a good candidate, you must produce it in enough quantity. So essential oils that are easy to produce. So we pre-select 91, and then we test in vitro with such a method. So yesterday you saw the method. It's a ELISA test indeed. So we use this microplate here, not for ELISA test, but for in vitro test against the pathogen. So if the pathogen is able to grow in the well, of course you will have an absorbance, and then you measure the absorbance, so you measure the development of the pathogen. And if with the essential oil you don't have, so you don't have absorbance. Okay? And of course here it's each well is an experiment, it's a trial. So it's really a fast way to do it. Then, from that experience, we selected some efficient essential oil. And of course, you know, even for human, essential oil sometimes can be toxic for your skin, or you can have allergy. So we have to check for the plants if it's phytotoxic or not. So you can imagine that for aquaponics, you have also to check for the fish. It's really important. And then here you've got some example where, yes, we had some phytotoxicity. Each drop here is the resultant of phytotoxicity of the essential oil. So of course, we eliminate this kind of candidates. And some, we didn't have any phytotoxicity. And then we go in vivo. We check if in vivo we have still efficacy. Why did we go that way? It's because in vitro, we have a lot of, we have 90 essential oil, 2 concentration against 20 pathogen. So, of course, it's fast. And when we've got a reduced number of essential oil, then we can go and check the efficacy in planta. Okay, and here, for example, it's against a fungus, Cercospora beticola. And we try 2 way of treatment, a curative way and a preventive way. So preventive, it means that you spray before the infection. And curative, it means that your pathogen is already infecting the plant, and then you go after the inoculation. Okay, and we could have some results. You see here the control with different spots, and one of example of result with much less spots than the control. This, I think I told you already, make a literature in parallel with the selection, literature analysis to see tox and ecotox, and production also it's important. So mass production. This is not so mass production here. For microorganisms, mass production, you can have what we call submerged culture or semi-solid culture. Submerged culture is done for bacteria, for yeast, and semi-solid culture is done for mycelial fungi mainly. Okay, and there are a lot. It's a science on itself, so I won't take time on that. If you want to have some more questions, you can ask after. Then the formulation. The formulation, it's important. It's important because it will help, and I told you with microorganisms, it's important to have a good shelf life when you store the product. It has to be easy to prepare. It helps to make the product easy to prepare and to apply. But it's not enough for with microorganisms. When you apply it, you want to make sure that your microorganism will prolifer, will multiply on the surface of your plant. You want also to stimulate the way it's acting against the pathogen, so what we call the mode of action. We want to be sure that it reaches your plant and stay on your plant, and it's compatible with other, with your biocontrol agent. An adjuvant of formulation might be not toxic for your microorganism if it's a living microorganism. To obtain dry formulation, and this is often what we have with microorganisms, because when you reduce the percentage of water in your formulation, you ensure that your microorganisms don't have an active metabolism. So we will survive longer. Okay, so we can have atomization. It's like a spray dry at high temperature. But that kind of technique, you need a microorganism which is able to resist to such high temperature. So for example, the spores of bacillus. Freeze drying is very soft method, but it's very expensive. And drying on fluid bed, on fluidized bed, and this is the most used method to dry a microorganism in the biocontrol area. And these are formulations that you can obtain. You can see wettable powders, dust, gels, granules, pills, pellets, also emulsion, but better an emulsion in the oil. So it's an inverted emulsion. It's oil in water. You've got here example of microorganism with example of the way they were formulated, if you want to have a look. And here you've got also example of adjuvant of formulation. I told you it has to, it can help, for example, to improve the spreading when you spray on your plant, to maintain the stability during application, to prevent premature drying, because, for example, some microorganisms are really sensitive to low relative humidity. So you want to prevent low relative humidity. You add hygroscopic agent, and so on and so on. So really, the goal is to make it easy to apply and to make your microorganism able to survive and to multiply on your plant. And here is a practical product. This product is called Pre-Stop and Pre-Stop Mix. So this is the commercial name. I deal with this product for a few years. So I've experienced this, and I often had good results. It's Gliocladium catenulatum. This is the active ingredient. See, it's a fungus. And you can see that it can be used to treat the substrate. We were speaking about that with Kevin. So you can treat the substrate of your hydroponic part of your aquaponic system. You can treat directly your plants. And you can see, of course, when you treat the substrates, it's against root disease, like Fusarium, Phytophthora, Rhizoctonia. You can treat also part of the plant. It's also able to survive on the leaves, on the upper part of the plant. So it's able to protect the plant against some areal pathogens like Dithymella, like botrytis. You saw it this morning. And one funny things is treatment of gray mold caused by botrytis. And instead of, I will come later on, instead of spraying your biocontrol agent here, the honeybee will be the vector to spray. So you will see later. So here you've got two different formulations. One which is used for really hydroponic system. So of course it's an hygroscopic formulation, so it dissolves very well in the water. And it can also be applied to inorganic substrate like rockwool and perlite. So very good. That could be one of the potential already existing biopesticides that we can try. We never try ourselves in aquaponic system, but that could be. And of course, the other one is another formulation. It will be transported by pollinators. So we have, it's not hygroscopic, it's not soluble in the water. And indeed, the border is not so fine because it has to attach on the air of the insect. Another example of formulation is the yeast against post-harvest pathogen on apples and pears. And it was produced in fermenter, as you can see. And the formulation is granules. So granules, it's a little bit better than wet powder because you don't have dust. It's attached some granules, so you have less dust with such a product. With essential oil, I would say that formulation is essential because they are sensitive to different points. They are really sensitive to UV radiation, and they are also sensitive to volatiles extract. And another point is because they are essential oils, they are not soluble in water, so they are hydrophobic. So we really need to formulate the essential oil to protect them against UV and to have a stable emulsion. And that was the work that we've done in our laboratory. You can see here that we try several combinations of adjuvant, resulting in microemulsion. This is a macro emulsion, the mini emulsion, and the micro emulsion. And the more the thinner are the size of the drop, the more transparent is the solution or emulsion. So you see here. And another important point is the stability. The stability when you are treating your plant is important. And you can see here that after a few minutes, it's already, so the emulsion is already separated, whereas with micro emulsion, it's really stable. And here it's with a triple adjuvant. You see under a microscope that it's really, really little drop of essential oil in the water. And what was surprising us is that we also increased the efficacy when we had a good emulsion. And here, for example, we try the same essential oil at the same level of concentration, but we try several adjuvants, and some which were really good to make really small drop were more efficient than other one, as you can see here. After formulation, let's move to the mode of action. Mode of action, it means how your biocontrol agent is acting against your pathogen. So how does it work indeed? And it's important to know the mode of action, because when you know it, you can select even more efficient strain which have the mode of action. Maybe you can also improve genetically your strain, but then you've got GMO or even genetic manipulated microorganisms, or GMM, which is not something that will be applied in Europe. So another way to increase the efficacy is not genetic manipulation, but appropriate formulation, which will be enhanced. And you will see a case of study after. Quality of the production, you can check when you produce your microorganism if it's producing, for example, an enzyme or something which is important for the protection. It helps also to determine the application period. I will come back later on that. And anyway, it is necessary for your registration dossier. You need, before commercialization, to make a registration dossier, to submit your dossier to the European authorities, and they ask for what is the mode of action of your microorganism? What is the mode of action of your essential oil? You need to give data. So when we are speaking about microorganisms, it's sometimes difficult to really understand because the situation is complex. You've got your plant to protect, you've got the pathogen, you've got the biocontrol agent, and furthermore, you've got other microorganisms, and certainly with aquaponic system. So in order to simplify the system, most of the experiments are done in vitro. So we get rid of the plant, and we just have the pathogen, the microorganism, and we see what kind of mode of action we have. Another possibility is to work with genetically modified microorganisms, just as scientific tool, not to release in the nature. That can help, but sometimes it's difficult because you need to have the tool to make this microorganism modified. So most of the study we have still indirect evidence of the mode of action. These are kind of literature review done a few years ago on apples and pears. And you can see that most of the mode of action was nutrient for competition for nutrient and physic competition. So what does it mean? It means that when your microorganism arrive to the plant, the microorganisms multiply and take out all the nutritive element. And when your parasite or your pathogen arrive, there is no nutritive element for the pathogen, or there is no space. So it means that it is a preventive action. So remember, I told you that it is necessary to know the mode of action because we will know when you will have to apply. Here, if your mode of action is competition for nutrient, it's a preventive biocontrol agent. Antibiosis is the production of a metabolite or of antibiotic, which is able to inhibit the development of the pathogen. Here, it can have a curative effect. So if a microorganism has such mode of action, maybe you can use it as a curative product. Induction of host resistance. So some microorganisms are able, and we will come back later, to produce elicitors which stimulate the defense of the plant. And finally, you can have a direct interaction. So it means that your microorganism is able to degrade the cell wall of your pathogen and to eat. It's like an alien, you know? So the protection can be due to one or several of these mode of action. If we speak about a mode of action with microorganisms, this is the four main major mode of action. And here you've got mode of action of the gliocladium catenulatum. And you can see, as I told you, it's like alien. This is the mycelium of the pathogen, and this is the mycelium of gliocladium. And you can see that it can enter into the pathogen, colonize it, and it kills the pathogen like that. And there are various mode of action, so we call that hyperparasitism, but also competition for nutrient and space. We didn't detect any antibiosis in this case. But anyway, we have several mode of action. It means that there is a weak probability to have a resistance to this biocontrol agent. I told you that if we know the mode of action, sometimes we can stimulate the mode of action with a more appropriate formulation. Just want to give you an example here. So let's come back to our biocontrol agent, Candida oleophila, the yeast, Botrytis cinerea, which is the pathogen, and the apple. Here, what we observe is we were able to purify glucanase produced by the yeast. I don't know if you're familiar with glucanase. It's an enzyme which is able to degrade glucan. And glucan are part of the cell wall of the fungi. So we were thinking, maybe the glucanase is able to degrade the cell wall of the fungi, like we can see here, and help to take out all the nutrients from the pathogen. And here you've got an image, microscopic image, with Botrytis cinerea growing alone. You can see the spore and the hyphae. And here, this is Botrytis with the enzyme. And you can see first that the hyphae are really short in comparison with the control. And you can see also that there is some, you know, you see like some clouds behind the spores. It means that the cell wall were degraded. Okay? So it's a good point. But it's in vitro. So we don't have a demonstration in vivo. So for the demonstration in vivo, we were working with what we call disruption strategy. It means that in your cell, you inactivate the gene responsible of the production of the glucanase. So it's really an elegant technique because you can come back to the apple, to the reality, to apple, pathogen, the yeast, except that the yeast do not produce anymore the glucanase. So what's happened? And we discovered two glucanase. So you've got here the wild strains, here disrupted for one glucanase, for the other one, and for both glucanases. And this is percentage of protection. So when we have disruption of the glucanase, we decrease, you can see. And here, that was the first time that we demonstrate really the implication of glucanase on the protection. Here, this is for Penicillium expansum. And you can see here a cumulative effect. One glucanase, a second one, and with a double disruption, so no glucanase 1, no glucanase 2, we even have less a percentage of protection. So knowing that, we can have a more appropriate formulation. And we try to find products or molecules which mimics the pathogen cell wall. And we try several pathogen cell wall. Again, we speak about percentage of protection. You see these different molecules mimicking pathogen cell wall. There is no protection in comparison. I mean, it's not no protection. But when we apply our strain at a concentration 100 times less than normally, plus the molecule, we obtain similar level of protection. So thanks to that, we can increase the protection. Knowing the mode of action, you can increase the protection. It's a bit complicated, but maybe it helps also if once you want to develop a biocontrol for aquaponic system, you can also use this strategy. So concerning essential oils, what are the mode of action? Until now, we find a lot of literature against human pathogens or animal pathogens, but not a lot against plant pathogens. So it's a general figure I show you here. Normally, essential oil can have several targets in the cells. First one, they are able to perturb the membrane of the cell, and they damage the cell. They can also act to coagulate the cytoplasm and also to have some damage on lipid and proteins. So normally they have also a multi-action, and it means that if there are several targets, the risk of pathogen resistance is reduced. But of course, as I told you, if we speak about essential oil, then you have to be sure that you will not have specific taste for your fish, or it doesn't affect the health of the fish, and so on. Then ecology. Here you've got the ecology of the Gliocladium. Indeed, the Gliocladium, this strain, was isolated from Nordic soil, so Finnish soil. You can imagine it, sometimes it can be very cold there. And they observe that the biological activity is between 6 and 30 degrees. It's good to know that, because in greenhouse sometimes 30 degrees, you can reach more than 30 degrees. It happened. But we know also that it's able to survive until 40 degrees. So there, between 30 and 40, you will not have an active fungus against your pathogen, but it will be able to survive. Okay? And here, this is also something a bit strange for me, but it represents that Gliocladium is able to colonize roots and also to colonize leaf. So it doesn't matter if you apply it on the root system or on the leaf surface. So normally, a microorganism is better adapted to one of the situation, but here it seems to be adapted to both situations. Okay, mode of action of feliciter. So I think it's important also to speak about feliciters to you, because that kind of tools could really be applied in aquaponic system. Normally, the molecules or the substance act as a signal perceived by the plants, and which is able to induce or to stimulate defense of the plant. So it's an indirect effect. Okay. So with a priori, we could say that if it's indirect effect, there is no harmful. It might be not harmful for the fish, or even for the other microorganisms in the aquaponic system. So definitively, this is one tool that could be applied in aquaponic system. How does it work? The root or the leaf can perceive the molecule or the substance, and there is a signal in the plants resulting in induction of defense. And I will not go into the details with you, but what are the main defense reactions? Oxidative reaction, so it's a burst, so it's immediately you've got where the pathogen is, you've got programmation of cell death, okay, thanks to this burst, and it stops the development of the pathogen, so it's a really quick answer. But you have also other answer, thanks to ion flux, and it arrived to the synthesis of molecules by the plant, which are, for example, phytoalexin or peer proteins. I don't want to say that it's like immunoglobulin, but it's similar. So your plant develop some substance which are toxic for the pathogen. So again, this is why I want to really highlight this, because that could be a possibility for an aquaponic system. And you've got three categories of elicitors: pumps, dumps, and mumps. So pumps is pathogen associated molecular pattern. What does it mean? It means that the signal, I mean the perception from the root or the perception on the leaf is coming from the pathogen. It can be something from the cell wall of the pathogen, like chitin, for example, or some glycopeptide from the pathogen, and so on. Dumps, it's coming from the plant itself. Due to the interaction of the pathogen and the plant, for example, to penetrate to the, the pathogen to penetrate to the plant, degrade some part of the plant, and the resulting molecules are the molecules who are triggering the defense of the plant. This is dumps. And of course, for example, oligogalacturonate, it's a molecule that you can find easily in the cell wall of the plant. And mumps, it's microbial associated molecular patterns. It's coming from microorganisms, like plant growth promoting rhizobacteria. So some bacteria can have an effect. The presence of the bacteria can be the signal for the plant to stimulate the defense. And you see here the different possible mumps, dumps, and pumps origin. You can see also that for dumps and pumps, they need a specific receptor for the plant cell to have the translation of the signal. Okay. And something I want to say also is that you have what we call a systemic response of the plant. For example, you can have a PDPR, so a rhizobacteria here, the presence, not attacking, but just the presence of the rhizobacteria is a signal. And the signal can be translocated through all the plant. And it can protect against a pathogen a leafy pathogen. Okay. So it's really nice because these elicitors are general elicitors, so it can have an action to a broad spectrum of pathogens. But again, I didn't see any example in aquaponic system. I don't have an example. And another point is that until now, elicitors are really depending on the physiology of the plant. If the plant is vigorous, it will react, to simplify, it will react really actively thanks to the molecule or the elicitor. And in some stage, it will not. So we don't have, always reliable efficacy in the field. And another point, because it's basal resistance, you don't have a high efficacy. And we have already some elicitor registered at the European level. And because they don't have a high efficacy, in general, they are applied in combination or in alternance with other treatments. Okay.
In fish, with fish, we are now trying to use nutrition to change immunity. But there's a doubt if it's, sometimes we think it's good to have a more innate immunity that is more responsive. But there are people who say that it's also dangerous because the fish can be respond too much, so it's
over response.
So
yeah,
maybe it's better to have a lower innate immunity. Is it similar with plants or?
Okay, good question. We have some results with. I have an example in mind with a chemical elicitor. And the commercial name is Bion. And there are some results showing that if you have a high level of to answer to your a high level of stimulation of defense, your metabolism is directed to that, and the energy is directed to that. So it means that the plant were not growing as fast as the other. So that can be a problem, but not all the elicitors are reacting like that. Another point to mention here, it's depending also on the dosage you are applying, and you can have also what we call priming effect. A priming effect is you don't have a real stimulation of all the defense of the plant. So it's not the plant don't put a lot of energy. But if a pathogen is coming, they are reacting faster than without priming.
That's the point. Yeah.
So of course, practical trial is important, one of the last steps. And here I will present some results obtained with Gliocladium. And this result, I did it myself when I was working for the private company. So I'm really confident in this. in you see here botrytis cinerea. So for tomatoes in greenhouse, when your tomato is growing, you want to cut the
branches
because it will consume the energy not for fruiting. So you cut them. But it's a wound, and botrytis like wounds. So they like to penetrate, and it's an opportunistic pathogen. And we try to protect I won't go into the detail of the protocol. You can read it after if you want. We try to protect by spraying the stem, and we really obtain good result, as good as the fungicide reference. So that was really a good point. And a second year, we obtain similar results in a preventive action. You can see here that curative action, no way. So it helps you to make the right position. But this is also something important to tell you now. In practical, a grower, he wants to apply a treatment if there is a disease. So most of the grower will use curative treatments. So you have to convince here the grower, please go with the preventive treatment. Maybe you're not sure that the botrytis will come or not, but if it's there, it will block. So it's another challenge when we are speaking with the biocontrol agent, because most of the biocontrol agent has a preventive action and not a curative action. Here, this is another fungus. It's Microsparella. It used to be called Ditimella. And you can see that it can damage cucumber. So you have to throw away the cucumber if you are in an industrial industrial producer. And we decrease the infected plants. And we also, and this is a funny part, we also try this gliocladium against botrytis on strawberries. And here you have to know the cycle of the pathogen. Indeed, most of the strawberries are infected when, due to the fact that botrytis, again, it's an opportunistic pathogen, it will infect not the fruit, but the flowers when you've got that, you arrive to at a senescence stage, when the petals are nearly falling down. And of course, if you want to use the formulation of Gliocladium as a spray, but, and you know that the strawberry, the flowering, it's not one time, but the period of flowering can be a few weeks, so you have to repeat the treatment. And that was done, so you can see here the stamen, for example, part of the flower, with botrytis developing, and here you don't have so much botrytis developing when you've got gliocladium. And this is a result. You see here that untreated was the so it was a 100% the reference, okay? And if you have gliocladium in alternance with a fungicide, you can obtain even better, you can have better marketable yield. Okay? Yield. And now comes, because you have to use a lot of spray, 3-4 times during the flowering season. So the people from Scandinavia start to try with honeybees. So the honeybees are obliged to go through this this door. So they take with them the powder, and of course they go and apply gliocladium when you've got nice flowering, so before senescence of the flower, so before botrytis can attack. And with this, they try it also with bumblebees. So bumblebees are well adapted for greenhouse environment. And of course, they are used in Belgium, in Holland, under greenhouse environment to pollinate strawberries, but also to pollinate tomatoes and so on. And these are the results. You can see that year, beginning of the season, they have 9% of infected berries, and with pre-stop, lower, not as good as the chemical treatment, but already better. And it was here with honeybees, and that's for the main trial, it was nearly similar, okay? And with bumblebees, this is the action. You can see that, yes, chemical was the best, but the second one was gliocladium transported by bumblebees here, okay? So now, in organic crops and in some, even in some conventional intensive integrated pest management crops, this system is used in Belgium and in Holland. You can imagine that we had to struggle a lot with the registration because it's so unconventional way to apply the biopesticide. And here are the results. Okay, so you see the method of application by spray for wound, pruning wound on tomatoes or by bumblebees. Hmm? But gliocladium is also able to protect root against root disease. You've got here an example of sweet pepper, the roots of sweet pepper. So you see now the big stone wool. And you can see that this is the root system attacked by Phytophthora. And here is with gliocladium, we had better root system. Here with, it's with damping off against pitium. It's damping off, sorry, due to pitium or rhizoctonia. Again, better results.
Did you also spray it on the surface or of the soil, or how did you apply it for the root protection?
Here we spray the substrate. Yes. So you can spray the growing medium, or you can incorporate into the liquid for the, your hydroponic system. So, yes, the way you are treating, it's raining again, the way you are treating the system is also important. And maybe for aquaponic system, I don't know, it should be better just to spray the growing medium if we don't know the impact of gliocladium on fish and on other bacteria. Practical application of the yeast on post-harvest pathogen. We made a lot of experience and we could see that it was better with here at the laboratory level, even small scale. And of course, we also went to a big practical trials. And you see here a practical trials done in Spain where black mûr, this is the chemical reference composed, and it's include, sorry, two active ingredients. And here, this is Candida oleophila. And you can see that it was here even better thanks to the appropriate formulation which enhanced the mode of action. Okay, and here, in picture, you can see that the fruits were healthier in comparison with untreated and even in comparison with the chemical treatment. So sometimes we can also have really efficient control thanks to biocontrol agents. For essential oils, we also apply it here in our laboratory. And you can see here preventive effect and curative effect. So this is a control. This is a infected foliar area in percent. So we have 14% of infection surface area. And you can see that some of the essential oil were able to protect against the disease. Of course, this is preliminary practical trials. We still need to work on it. Here, against strawberry, against powdery mildew, and we were speaking about downy mildew yesterday, but here is an example of powdery. It's a white fungus. It's a biotrophic fungus. Obligate pathogen, and it's really stay in the surface of the leaf, and you can see the difference. We had good, quite good control here. Last step, registration. When you finish your development, you have the right microorganism. You demonstrate efficacy, you know the mode of action, you know the ecology, you have some practical trials, okay. Then comes the registration. Registration is really important. I told you, you cannot commercialize your product without any registration. The goal is to guarantee the efficacy of a biopesticide and its harmlessness for the user, consumer, and environment. And again, for aquaponics, environments mean fish and also other bacteria in the biofilter. And you should work as soon as possible. And I told you, if you have one substance, essential oil, or one microorganism, you know the species, go to the data bank to see if it's toxic or not for human, if it's if you have data for to be harmless or harmless or to be harmful, sorry, for the environment, stop. So this is really important. Otherwise, you will work for a few years because I show you your work of a few years for apples, for example, and for nothing at the end. So it's very important to really, as soon as possible, have some idea about toxicity. So in USA, one important difference between USA and Europe is that in USA, they don't ask you efficacy data. So you can sell a product to a grower which has no efficacy. They don't care. The culture in US is that the market will make the difference. So maybe the grower will buy the product the first year, and after that, he won't buy it anymore. In Europe, you have to provide efficacy data. Here, you know, Europe is more social, so they want to protect the grower, the end user. So they want to be sure from the beginning that if you come with a product, it's efficient against a pathogen. So this is the main difference. And another main difference is that US really stimulates the development of biocontrol agents. Even 36 years ago, there was already a unique legislation in USA. And you've got also a bigger market than, you know, all the little national country in Europe. And if you go to the EPA, you can also read biopesticides are inherently less harmful than conventional pesticides. So they've got a positive a priori. Of course, for us scientists, we don't have positive or negative a priori. And we know that some substance from nature can be really toxic, like digitaline. I don't know the name. It's from digital in French. It's at a small dose. It's helped to for your heart, but if you take a lot of those, heart attack. It's over. For
example.
Exactly, digitalis. So for it, it's just one example for many other. So okay, but it means also that with this positive a priori, the development of biocontrol agents in USA was stimulated, okay, and it needs only 2 years to have the registration. In Europe, so this is, if you want to go a little bit further in detail, this is the requirements for the dossier. And you see a description of the active ingredient, where do you use it, the target pest, assessment of risk of to human health, to environment, and so on. And what is good, it's a case-by-case study. And if you have enough data from scientific point of view, you don't have to start again to produce all this data. So the dossier sometimes is lighter than in Europe. So in Europe, we won't have any harmonized legislation until May 2001. until 1993. And from that 1993, there was a directive saying that biological control agent is a plant protection product, and they have to fulfill exactly the same requirement as a chemical product. So it didn't stimulate the development of biocontrol agent. And after May 2001, there was a novel directive. There, they differentiate chemicals from biological control agents. And they ask for specific data for biocontrol agents. It was also a case-by-case study, but at least 3 years for the first authorization. And at that period, I had some data showing that in average, more than 50 months were necessary to have your product registered. Can you imagine that an enterprise submit a dossier, need to win their life, and they have to wait for 50 months? So more than 4 years. And now they learn from that. It's really slowly in Europe. But they learn, and since June 2011, they apply the regulation I have already shown you before. They also have some plan to have IPM development, so to make to favor biocontrol agents development, and also to promote low risk product and biological control measure where in place where there are a lot of public in the cities. For example, this is why now, in the cities, they don't use anymore, most of the cities don't use anymore herbicides. And you know, they have mulching and so on to avoid weeds, but because they don't use herbicides anymore. So it helps really, and it promotes finally the biological alternative in Europe. And this is a different requirements, and efficacy is also required here. So I will end with some conclusions. So biocontrol agent generates great enthusiasm despite some relevant drawbacks I told you. Efficacy, reliability, storage of the product before use. But there is growth of the market. You are really on the beginning of development of the market. US and Europe are the two largest biocontrol market. Asia is also offering a great future. Yes, and this is controlled because insect was the main market for biocontrol agents in the past, and now disease control is a new developing market, so to control fungal disease and bacterial disease. Until now, microbial pesticides are the most developed in terms of number and term of turnover. Elicitors are emerging tools on the market, but I told you that reliability and level of efficacy are still to be improved. Botanicals are coming now. They are in development. It's not yet, we don't have a lot of products, so it's not yet a mature product market. But, and also we have other natural compounds, it exists, but should review more carefully on a case-by-case basis. So I believe that biocontrol might be in the future essential for the development of plant protection in aquaponic system. Of course, if we want to go fast, it's better to test and to try already registered and existing product available on the market. But then we have to see the impact of aquaponic condition on the BCA, impact of the BCA on the fish, health, taste, and so on, and impact on the biocontrol agent on other microorganisms useful for plant nutrition. And we can go also to another direction. The second strategy is to select novel biocontrol agent. I think the first thing is to explore the aquaponic microbiota. We don't have a lot of information on that. And then we have to see if we can select one super strain or if we define condition in favor of beneficial microbiota. So thank you. And,